Earth is warming, caused by the burning of fossil fuels like oil, coal, and natural gas, filling the atmosphere with heat-trapping gases like carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, at levels humans have never seen before. As the world debates how much more warming the planet can take, 1.5 degrees Celsius, 2 degrees Celsius, the climate crisis escalates.
The problems are that the world is becoming too hot for the present distribution of people, agriculture, human welfare, and human interest. And it's getting worse.
But it's more than our emissions heating the globe. Something else is at work here. The rising temperatures are setting in motion Earth's own natural warming mechanisms that then feed upon themselves. George Woodwell, a distinguished scientist and a lion of the environmental movement, has been sounding the alarm about them for the past 50 years. In a 1989 Scientific American article, he wrote that warming caused by human activity, rapid now, may become even more rapid as a result of the warming itself. 30 years later, climate activist Greta Thunberg repeated his warning, calling them irreversible chain reactions.
The popular idea of cutting our emissions in half in 10 years only gives us a 50% chance of staying below 1.5 degrees and the risk of setting off irreversible chain reactions beyond human control. 50% may be acceptable to you, but those numbers do not include tipping points, most feedback loops, additional warming hidden by toxic air pollution, or the aspects of equity and climate justice.
So what exactly are irreversible chain reactions? What scientists refer to as feedback loops.
A feedback that everybody is familiar with is an audio feedback, where if you put a microphone too close to a speaker, you get this terrible high-pitched screaming. And that happens because the sound comes out of the speaker and it goes back into the microphone. That's called a positive feedback because it amplifies the loop.
Instead of the guitar, emissions from fossil fuels are the input which add heat-trapping gases to the atmosphere, raising Earth's temperature and setting in motion self-perpetuating warming loops, warming as a result of the warming itself. That ever-growing screeching noise is an apt analogy for the damage that human-caused feedback loops are wreaking on the planet. Scientists have identified dozens of feedback loops already in motion. It's imperative that we understand them if we're going to solve the climate crisis. As the climate warms, forests, once removers of carbon, release it back into the atmosphere as carbon dioxide, or CO2. Frozen ground in the northern hemisphere thaws and emits CO2 and methane. These are the kinds of feedback loops that lead to further warming, triggering the release of even more heat-trapping gases and raising the temperature even higher. In this series, we will highlight four of the major feedback loops impacting climate: the melting of sea ice in the Arctic Ocean, increased drought and fires in the world's forests, the decay of organic matter from permafrost thaw in the northern hemisphere, and disruptions to the jet stream and our global weather. Each amplifies warming, and combined, they are spinning out of control. If we take action now, we could slow, halt, or even reverse them before it's too late. If we don't, the planet will reach a tipping point where we will lose the world as we know it. And what does that tipping point look like?
A simple example of that would be if you push a ball up a hill, at some point you're going to get to the top of the hill and it's going to roll down the other side. There are some things like that in the climate system where it's really hard to get it back once it's rolled down to that other side and now it's sitting in a new valley.
With more than 7.5 billion people on Earth, a change this great would spell catastrophe. Humans are well suited to the world we've known. The sun's radiation passes through atmospheric gases, primarily oxygen and nitrogen, to the Earth's surface. Some radiation is absorbed by the planet, and the rest would bounce back to space if it weren't for a tiny percentage of gases like carbon dioxide, methane, water vapor, and others that trap heat and warm the atmosphere. These heat-trapping greenhouse gases make up less than 1% of the total atmosphere, but they are essential in regulating the temperature. Without them, we would freeze, but too much of them would overheat the planet. Both are possible and have happened in Earth's geologic past.
So the kinds of things that keep climate scientists awake at night stem from their familiarity with the geological record that shows that the climate is capable of very abrupt changes. There are feedbacks operating in the climate system that may temporarily go out of control, if you will, and drive the climate to a different state. We cannot rule out that we may be in for such an abrupt change. So we don't fully understand them, but we worry about that a lot.
These radical changes include extreme temperature swings. During periods known as Snowball Earth, it got so cold the planet was covered completely in snow and ice. These alternated with hothouse climates, when virtually all the ice melted. Dinosaurs lived at the poles where forests and swamps flourished. These abrupt shifts were caused by complex global processes. This is the first time that humans have been responsible for an abrupt change. Today, Earth would naturally be in a cooling trend, but because of human activity, it's not.
We know from paleoproxy records that the Earth has been cooling for about 7,000 years. We recovered from the peak of the last ice age, which was about 22,000 years ago, went up, and it's been slowly cooling until about the time of the Industrial Revolution.
At that time, humans began emitting vast amounts of carbon dioxide. Since then, the atmospheric content of CO2 has gone from 280 parts per million to over 400 today, and could approach 800 by the end of the century. Of all the carbon dioxide humans emit each year, oceans absorb about one quarter. Plants take up another quarter, and the other half stays in the atmosphere, accumulating over time and raising Earth's temperature. But the percentage nature removes is shrinking every year as forests are destroyed and oceans warm. Scientists estimate that doubling CO2 from pre-industrial levels could produce an increase in temperature of up to 8 degrees Fahrenheit, resulting in the deaths of millions of people and the loss of countless species. It's this human-caused warming that's kicking off Earth's natural feedback loops and heating up the planet further. National Medal of Science recipient Warren Washington, a groundbreaking climate pioneer, began creating computer models in the 1960s to predict the future of atmospheric warming and the role feedback loops play.
The question always was, how do we see the feedback mechanisms working realistically? We really don't know if we've got the right amount of feedback in our models, because they're so complicated in many cases. We had to do a lot of experimenting.
That experimenting, coupled with observations, paid off. Because of that groundwork, today's models have more accurately predicted what we're seeing today and what our future holds. This kind of research is crucial to understanding the policies we need to implement to avoid disaster going forward.
Climate policy really should be designed to avoid crossing the important thresholds, avoid crossing the important tipping points, and avoid setting off these important feedbacks. Because we need to essentially ask the question, you know, how much warming is okay? Is 2 degrees okay? Is 1.5 degrees okay? We really don't know the answer to that very well.
And yet we continue to add more heat-trapping gases to the atmosphere, setting off irreversible chain reactions.
Where we are now is like driving in a car in a dense fog, and you know there's a cliff out there somewhere, but you don't know where. Do you want to be going 60 miles an hour, or you should be going about 10 miles an hour?
Today we have a choice. If we take our foot off the accelerator, stop deforestation, and regreen the Earth, we can reverse the feedback loops and begin to cool the planet.
And the solution is to make that transition away from fossil fuels and into a new green Earth. And it really does require a green Earth.
I'm encouraged by the fact that other countries have decarbonized their electricity sector in 10 to 12 years. So I know we can do it. And those countries that did it, by the way, grew their economies rapidly while doing it. But we have to put the incentives in place.
Even with meaningful incentives, it's going to take a while for the climate to recover.
Even if we stopped emitting carbon right now, it will take thousands of years for the system naturally to go back to what was before we started messing around with it. If we keep going industrially at the same rate we are now, we will have succeeded in roughly tripling the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere over its pre-industrial value by the end of the century.
We have the technology and knowledge to solve the problem, to stop and reverse the feedback loops. But we need leaders who understand the urgency of getting it done, and an energized public to advocate for change. It's not going to be easy. We've let the problem go on too long.
That isn't to say, though, that we shouldn't do everything we can possibly do to slow down our emissions, because we'll make it that much better for our kids and grandkids in the future. The problems won't be quite as big. The warming won't be quite as strong.
The Earth will be just fine. We may take along with us, unfortunately, lots of different species, but there have been catastrophic extinctions of species in the past. I'm not worried about the planet. I'm worried about us.
Every great change throughout history has come from the people. We do not have to wait. We can start the change right now. We, the people. Thank you.